Welcome back to part two of this four-part series of steel structure analysis, where we are modeling a modular house similar to this one being constructed in Brisbane, Australia. And in today's video, I'm going to be going over on how to properly apply claddings. I'm going to show you the easiest way to distribute dead, live, and wind loads on the structure. If you haven't watched part one yet, I'll leave the link in the description below, or just click on the link that will pop up somewhere here and make sure to head over and check it out. Hey, I'm Gabriel. I'm a qualified civil engineer practicing structural engineering in Queensland, Australia. And in today's video, we're going to learn together about structural modeling in Autodesk Robot. All right, since we have the entire structure already modeled, it's time to start applying the loads. However, in order to do so, we're going to create claddings, which are auxiliary objects that do not participate in the load capacity of the structure, such as panel walls, roofing and flooring, and it will facilitate generating loads. Click Geometry menu, Claddings, choose Rectangle as definition method, and start placing panel walls. Firstly, turn off section shapes so that you are able to snap the cursor to the corners. I'm picking three corners where beams meet columns, and the fourth will be generated automatically. So it's P1 on this corner, P2 on the other corner, and P3 to close the rectangle. And I'll do the same for all the perimeter walls. I'm going to fast forward a little bit here, but you can take your time to place all the wall claddings. Just go point by point, making sure your cursor snaps to the corners. Left bottom corner, right bottom corner, and top right corner. The direction doesn't matter as long as you follow a sequence of consecutive points. Right click on the mouse, choose select, and for visualization purpose, I'll select the whole bottom module and click Edit in New Window. Now I can easily create the flooring and roofing for the bottom module. I'm going to repeat the same process applied to the panel walls. Make sure you snap your cursor to the three corner points. And creating these panels will make our life easy in case we need to change loads, add or remove beams, so we don't need to calculate the tributary area every time we have to modify the design. Other software might not have this tool, thus you will have to create panels, mesh it, and apply zero density to it, which is, I think it's quite annoying. Hence, I'm glad that Robot has the cladding tool. Just an important reminder for you to take notes. Cladding do not transfer moment. They need to be directly connected to the beam. Therefore, ensure the bar axes are collinear with the edge of the claddings. Click exit to leave the window, and I'll start placing the flooring for the top module. As you can see, it's super easy and fast. Finishing off the flooring, I'll start the panel walls, choosing always three points if rectangle is selected. If your structure is not a quadrilateral, you can use contour as a definition method instead of rectangle. However, you will have to pick as many points as you need to close the contour. I will finalize with roof panels for the top module. Activate the view of section elements in this icon, and we can check if our structure is looking the way we expected. I'm going to activate local system where we will be able to determine a direction of the local axis assigned to each panel. I'm going to select the bottom floor and edit a new window to have a better visualization. The blue color represents the x-axis, the green color represents the y-axis, and the red color represents the z. And from here, we can check the direction of x, y, and z local axis. Select claddings. In the geometry tab, properties, change load distribution from two-way to one-way x, and the other ones should be one-way y. Right-click on the mouse, display panels, and tick the box of direction of load distribution. Apply and hit OK. This line represents the direction of loads, and the same will be distributed between this bar and this bar. Same applies here. As you must have realized, since I'm not modeling any joists, I'm using this cladding to represent the loads being transferred from joists to the main beams. I usually design the joists separately so I can give the client a timber or steel option. You're more than welcome to include joists in your model, but just bear in mind that it will be a bit more laborious adding joists at 450 millimeter centers, for example. If I Google joist systems images, it is something like that. Let's find a more clear photo, like this one. This is the joist system. Going back to robot, I'll do the same procedure for the floor of the top module. So select the floor structure and edit a new window. Select the claddings and change the load distribution direction to suit your needs. Following that, turn off local system. The direction of the loads is not shown here because I applied only to the last window, so I'll have to do the same steps again to display it. I will repeat that again in the main screen, and it should show the direction of the loads every time now. There we go. The same process applies to the roofing. However, now the claddings will represent the load being transferred from purlins to the main roof beams. Purlins transfer the roof loads to this beam, and do the same for the bottom module roof. Just another quick tip for you to take notes. Claddings are based on tributary areas, and be careful with point and linear loads as they can lead to distribution errors. I'm considering that the wind loads will be directed to the floor and roof beams, therefore my line of distribution of loads will be vertical on the panel walls. And the same principle applies to the bottom module panel walls. Since the sequence of points I picked when drawing the claddings differ from each one of them, some directions of load will be one way Y, while others will be one way X. Make sure you save your project regularly to avoid any headaches in case your computer crashes. All right, Claddings distribute the area loads to the beams. Robot automatically finds all bars in the plane and contour of a cladding, and it generates a linear or trapezoidal load on those bars. You can select objects that do not carry loads and lie in the plane of a cladding and ignore the same for the analysis. In a real structure, these can be elements of roof bracing that do not carry the load transferred from the roofing, for example. In our case, the loads coming from the cladding should not be transferred to the bracings. Therefore, I'll ignore their analysis. I'll quickly show you an example to make it clear. I'm gonna draw a simple frame with a couple of columns and beams and one diagonal bracing. Gonna apply some supports. Apply a cladding to one face of the structure. Gonna apply a area load to the cladding. Oops, that should be Y direction. As you can see, the area load is applied. Run the calculation. Activate direction of load distribution. Change the load direction to one way X. Go to display loads and forces generated automatically. This is one way that you can check that your loads have been correctly distributed to the members. So as you can see, the diagonal bracing is taking loads from the panel. However, the diagonal member is there only to brace the structure. Therefore, we can ignore its analysis and the force will be correctly distributed only to the beams. As you can see, force is distributed to the beams. Click here to turn off panel interiors. I'm going to select all my diagonal bracings. And on the geometry tab, model trapezoidal, ignore, so we can have the force correctly distributed to where we want. That was it for today. It was pretty simple. Just play around with it, run some analysis, check the results, see if it's similar to what you were expecting. And I hope you enjoyed the video. And if you have any questions, just drop a comment below. And I'll see you next time.